Have a nice day with Jesus. Have a nice day. Have a nice day with Jesus. Have a nice day. You may wish the sun would shine a little bit brighter, but when you've got the Lord, it'll make your load a lot lighter. So have a nice day with Jesus. Have a nice day. You can wake up every morning with a smile upon your face, just to know the Lord has kept you one more day. And no matter what the day may bring, you can face it with a smile, for the Lord will walk beside you all the way. Have a nice day with Jesus. Have a nice day. Have a nice day with Jesus. Have a nice day. You may wish the sun would shine a little bit brighter, but when you've got the Lord, he'll make your load a lot lighter. So have a nice day. Have a nice day. Anyone can sing when the sun is shining and everything seems to be all right. But it's a different story when you're talking. I'm talking about a rainy day. So let the Lord be your umbrella. He will take you through the storm. Give the world a smile and let them hear you say, have a nice day with Jesus. Have a nice day. Have a nice day with Jesus. Have a nice day. You may wish the sun would shine a little bit brighter, but when you've got the Lord, he'll make your load a lot lighter. So have a nice day with Jesus. Have a nice day. Have a nice day with Jesus. Have a nice day. Have a nice day with Jesus. Have a nice day. You may wish the sun would shine a little bit brighter, but when you got the Lord, it'll make your load a lot lighter. So have a nice day with Jesus. Have a nice day. So have a nice day with Jesus. Have a nice day. So have a nice day with my Jesus. Have a nice day. Have a nice
was just up there. I was going to remind everybody, Saturday night when you go to bed, make sure you spin it forward an hour so you aren't late to church. Hey, how's everybody this morning? Isn't that a beautiful day? What a wonderful week. We got lots of rain. We needed it. Thank you, Lord. Oh, let's open with prayer. Dear Father, thank you for this time that we can come. We can gather. We can praise you. Be with us now, Lord, as we listen to the word that you've given the pastor. Open our hearts to receive it in. And just hopefully enjoy us, Lord, as we praise you in song. I know you will. Thank you, Lord. Bless this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh, let's have our doxology. gives us 10,000 reasons to bless him.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name.
because he was at Calvary that we can sing his worships.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified.
Calvary, we can lean on the everlasting arms. Jesus has his arms out to hold you.
Everlasting arms.
Morning, family. That song, isn't that the truth? God will take care of us. So today, I was going through some of my notes and I was going through some of my ideas of, as pastors, everything could be made a sermon. Whenever you are sitting there talking to the pastor, be very careful because you may be the illustration of a sermon. And I happen to be going through some notes, and I happened upon a conversation that I had when I was first saved about preconceived notions that I had about books of the Bible. So today, we're going to look at one of these preconceived notions that I had. And yes, I'm using myself, and I'm not being vain, as an example, because it's very easy for us to have either the wrong idea or a very short version of an idea of what the books of the Bible have in store for us. If you'll please join me in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity that you bring to us every Sunday, Lord, bringing us together as your family so that we can sing your praises and just rejoice in knowing that you are with us. Lord, as we look into your word, I ask that you're with us, you guide us to learn what it is that we need to learn so that we could be better people, not just here, but in the future. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Now, when I was growing up, and this was the age before cell phones and before computers, I used to go and do something that is very unheard of nowadays. I would go out into this place that's a foreign land to most children called the outside. And I would go and I would visit my friends. Now, we didn't have the luxury of cell phones, so what I would do is I would go to their house, and first thing I would do is I'd look for the car, because most families that I knew back then didn't have more than one car. So if the car was in the driveway, we knew they were home. So I would go up and I would get to the door and I would knock, and I'd stand there and I'd wait. And I'd try to be patient, but you know, as a kid, patience only goes so far. So then I would think to myself, maybe they didn't hear, I'm gonna knock a little harder. So I would knock a little harder, a little more forceful. And I would strain to hear if I could hear anybody coming to the door, because the last thing you wanted to do was be caught leaning into the door when somebody opens it. It just looked weird. Even as a kid, that would look weird. Then you'd have to explain to your friend's mom why you're standing there creeping at the door. So at that point, when you second knock, I wasn't like Dennis the Menace. I didn't stand there and pound on the door going, I know you're in there. Open up. So what I would do is I would wait, and if I didn't get a response, now there's numerous reasons why I didn't get a response. Perhaps maybe they were eating lunch, eating dinner. Perhaps they were watching TV. Yes, we had TVs back then. They were very large and heavy, but we had them. But the thing is, maybe they were distracted by other things going on. They didn't hear me knocking. So I would get frustrated. And instead of being deterred, or instead of standing there and pounding on the door more, I would just move on to the next friend's house. And I would repeat the same thing over again. Now, you may be thinking, what does this have to do with the Bible at all? I'm using this as an illustration because most people can relate to knocking. Well, maybe not Caitlin, because she has a cell phone and she calls everybody. But most people can relate to knocking on a door and waiting for an answer. At least most people in this room anyway. We grew up before the age of right now. So what this has to do with anything is, think about this for a minute. Think about God when he knocks on your door and you're too busy to answer. Think about him waiting for you. Just like as an impatient child that I was waiting for an answer at the door. And then think about this. How would you feel? What would you do if God, like I did when I was a child, said, I've waited long enough, I'm moving on to the next? Now, thankfully, God doesn't do that. Thankfully, he's always there. He's always ready. It's whether or not we answer the door. But just think about for a moment, how would you feel if you missed answering the door to God? The sad truth is, there are a lot of times that God knocks on our door and we fail to answer. There are many that choose not to answer. If you're a child of God, I want to remind you that there is nothing more important in your life than God. There is nothing that should ever be put first before God in your life. Now, some people go, well, wait a minute, what about my family? No, God. Family. For some, like myself, it's God, family, friends, strangers, myself. But God should always be first. Because if we don't place God first, what happens is that we put ourselves in a position where we can fail to hear when he knocks. We could fail to answer the door when he calls upon us. I know that's an old saying too. You know, they used to say when somebody came to the door and knocked, they were calling on someone. That was even before my time. I borrowed that from way back in the 50s. Our verses today will be in Revelation, chapter 3, verses 15 to 22. Our text verse being verse 20. Now, usually, When anyone mentions the book of Revelation, people immediately think about judgment. They think about the end times. They think about, oh, all these signs I'm looking for. But without a doubt, there is judgment, significant judgment in the book of Revelation. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying there's not. But Revelation does not just end with judgment. Instead, now this is a beautiful thing. I want you to picture this for a moment. Picture this. You're reading the Bible, first chapter in the Bible. What does the Bible begin with? Paradise, right? Adam and Eve in paradise. The Bible ends the same way it began, in paradise. That is what we need to be looking at, not the judgment. We need to be aware of what judgment is to come so that we can avoid this judgment, so we can help others avoid the judgment. But what we need to focus on as Christians, as believers, is the hope, the blessed hope that we have that Revelation gives us. What awaits us is far more better than we could ever imagine. Paradise. It's a fitting end to the beginning. Revelation is a book about hope for the faithful in Christ. Our text verse, I'm not saying it's being used incorrectly now. Don't get me wrong, I'm not criticizing other pastors. But our text verse, verse 20, is often used as an invitation to non-believers so that they may receive Jesus as their Savior. But it applies directly to a church or a person that has become apathetic, like the church at Laodicea. This church had Jesus at their door. He was knocking. Jesus is willing to restore them to a better state, but they need to demonstrate their willingness to obey God. They need to open the door. I'm sure some of you have seen the picture. There's tons of pictures out there. One of the most well-known depiction of Jesus standing outside a door is this old door with rusty hinges, wooden door, and it's got a stone archway, and it's overgrown even. And Jesus is standing there waiting. That is the most common depiction that I've seen. And like I said, a lot of pastors use that, and they say, well, that represents non-believers. You could skew it that way. You could say it that way. But when we get done today reading Scripture, you're going to see that that's not how it was intended. That's not the message that was given. So if you haven't already, please turn to Revelation chapter 3. We're going to be starting in verse 15. Revelation 3, 15 says, I know thy works, and thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear. And anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh, I will grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. When we examine these verses, when we look at what they're truly saying, verse 15 and 16 refers to the members of the church as neither cold nor hot, but lukewarm. It's not a good thing to be lukewarm. Verse 17, the church, people, are very disagreeable to him, calling them wretched and as having vain opinion of themselves, being ignorant of their real state of being and case. Verse 18, he gives them some good counsel and advice, suitable to their condition, meaning he's giving them advice to help them out of the situation they're in, to make them truly rich and to clothe them and help them see the errors in their ways. Verse 19, it says, and whereas there are some among them he loved, he lets them know that he rebukes and chastens them, meaning he basically tells them what they're doing wrong. But he's not doing it out of spite. He's not doing it out of hate. He's doing it out of love. And with a view like that, he's doing it for one reason. He's doing it to prod them, to stimulate them to zeal, to have this zest, this love of Scripture, and to bring them to repentance for the apathy that they really truly feel. Because it said that they had no need. They had everything they wanted. They were rich, except for one thing. They didn't have Jesus. Now, 20, our text verse, he informs them of where he stands. Where does he stand? He's at the door. And what he expects from them. Answer the door. It's that simple. Answer the door. And then he explains what they could enjoy with him if they actually answered the door. Now in 21, Jesus continues his promise. Again, the Bible is filled with promises. All we have to do is read them and remind ourselves that, yes, God has promised us. God has given us promises that he will not break. So Jesus continues his promise that said to whoever responds to his call for a cordial welcome, meaning whoever receives me, thereby overcoming lukewarm faith, he promised to give them, those who overcome, the honor of sitting with him on his throne. Jesus mentioned that he sat down with his Father on his throne. Now we read this before, if you remember, in Hebrews 8:1. Hebrews 8:1 says, now this is the main point of things we are saying. We have such a high priest meaning Jesus, who is seated at the right hand of the throne of majesty in the heavens. That's powerful. We have somebody who is looking out for us, who's seated at the right hand of majesty. And in 22, Jesus has a final challenge. He has final words to the seven churches. Now, I understand you might not understand right now the seven churches. In Revelation, there are seven churches that Jesus addresses. Now, the seven churches of Asia Minor is what it is that he addresses. The challenge extends to us today, though. It's not just for those seven churches. It's for every believer. What it says is that we should listen. These messages that I'm talking about, I will go through them quickly. I'm not going to spend too much time on them because I will be going over them individually in future sermons because they do merit their own sermon. But here's the gist of what it is. To the church of Ephesus, the message was to keep our love for the Lord fresh and fervent. We can learn from this message that he had for the church of Smyrna to be faithful unto death. From his message to the church at Pergamum, we can learn to reject, now listen to this, because this applies directly to the United States and the rest of the world right now. We can learn to reject sexual immorality and the rule of others over the church. And what Jesus said to the church at Thyatira, we can learn to hold fast to the faith until Jesus comes, and he will come. From Jesus' message to the church at Sardis, we can learn to remember the truth and always stay alert. To his message to the church of Philadelphia, he teaches us to endure with patience the race set before us. And from the message that he gave to the Laodiceans, to the church there, which is what we are looking at today, we can learn to avoid being complacent and to keep our doors open for Jesus to enter every area of our lives. Not just what we choose to allow him into. When we return to our text verse that says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock, and if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and dine with him and he with me." When you read this, whatever translation you have, you can almost hear that this appeal is heartfelt. And it's urgent. If you think about it, if you really read it, it says, "Listen, I'm standing at your door and I'm knocking. If anyone hears my voice, open the door. I'll come into your home. I will share a meal with you. I will fellowship with you." The Lord's plea was also personal, though. It wasn't just for the church as a whole. Because when you read it, when you break it down, he spoke to individuals. If you notice, he used singular words like anyone. That doesn't mean just the whole church in general. Anyone. He says his, him, he. No, I'm not listing pronouns. That is what he's talking about, is individual. If he opens the door, I will sup with him. Individualized. The Lord was inviting everyone in the church to experience an intimate fellowship with him. And even though his desire was for the whole church, the entire church as a body, to answer the door, ultimately it's up to the individual whether or not they answer. I cannot open up the door to Christ for Brother Tina. I cannot open up your doors to the Lord. Only you can. Unfortunately, we also know that those he was addressing became lukewarm. That's a term I want to go back to for a minute. Most people wonder, what does that mean, lukewarm? What does it mean to be a lukewarm Christian? It means that they're not showing as much enthusiasm or interest in being with the Lord. They've wandered away from God. The church became full of itself. Didn't need God anymore. It was rich. It had everything it needed. This passage is addressed to the church, the followers of Jesus. Like I said, it often is used to address unbelievers because it can be addressed to unbelievers, people who don't know the love of God yet. But if we really look at what the message is, it's to each and every one of us who do believe. It's a cautionary tale. Believers can become lukewarm and feel that we are self-sufficient. I don't need God's help with this. I can handle this one on my own. You may say, well, there's nothing wrong with being self-sufficient. Wrong. Lukewarm Christianity teaches Christians, here's this thing that I hated a long time ago. I told you guys I hated one word in particular, compromise. Lukewarm Christianity teaches compromising our faith is acceptable. That is why we are in the situation we're in today with our churches. Because lukewarm pastors that don't want to offend people don't preach the gospel. They preach, let's go along to get along. Instead of standing for righteousness, lukewarm Christianity encourages the body of Christ to remain neutral. One of the biggest problems with this right now is abortion. That's one of the biggest problems. That's one of the ones that you can point to every time. Lukewarm Christianity encourages Christians to remain neutral. I don't have a dog in the fight. Nope, can't say I one way or another. No. Wrong. When the body of Christ becomes neutral, we also become ineffective, which is something else we're seeing in our communities, in our state today, in our country today. We are losing ground when it comes to our values. The core values that this country was founded on are being lost because lukewarm Christians don't want to create problems. So they just say, oh, whatever, it's okay. We'll pick our battles. The problem is that they haven't picked one yet. That's the problem. We relinquish the power and authority over what we believe and who we follow to those who wish to change the standards of what we continue to call righteousness to fit their own agendas. We let the world dictate what we see as right instead of what the Bible tells us is right. That's why we have so many confused Christians walking around going, I support abortion. I'm sorry, what? No. If you are a Christian, you cannot support the murder of an unborn child. But because lukewarm Christianity, lukewarm pastors, lukewarm Christians and followers of Christ don't want to stand for anything, they allow society to tell them it's okay. And they change it. They change their beliefs. In doing so, the one thing that you can guarantee is that we push Jesus out of our daily lives. We remove God from our daily lives and leave him standing outside our doors. We don't invite him in. We don't answer that door. That picture that the verse paints, the one that I talked about with the door and the overgrown and the arch, when you look at that, you could think of that as your heart. Jesus is standing there at a hardened heart. And he's waiting for you to open your heart again. And he's asking. He's not even forcing. He's asking to come in. Now I can go on. I get animated sometimes about lukewarm Christians. I could go on for a while about that. I'll be content, though, in giving you a couple of examples, just so you can examine yourselves. As Paul says, examine yourself. I want you to examine yourselves. I want you to listen to these, and I want you to see if there is any possibility that you're in danger of becoming a lukewarm Christian. I'm just going to give you 6 examples. If you're content without Jesus, I'm not going to do the redneck thing. I knew some people were waiting. You might be a lukewarm Christian. Okay, I got it out of the way. Now, if you are content without Jesus, meaning a lukewarm Christian doesn't have any desire to spend time with Jesus. They don't want to pray. They don't participate in worship. They don't read their Bibles. That is a sign, here's your sign, that you could be a lukewarm Christian. Okay? You ignore teachings and convictions, meaning you don't allow other Christians, you don't allow the Holy Spirit, or even the Bible to counsel you on things that are you're doing wrong. Because in your mind, in your opinion, you know what's best. Doesn't matter what other Christians say. It doesn't matter even what the Bible says. And you know what? The Holy Spirit can keep trying to convict me all they want. It's not going to happen. That is a lukewarm Christian. They put themselves above anything else. Another sign would be you would rather remain neutral than live set apart. We know that we are not to be of this world. We are to live set apart from this world. We are to be models of what we should be in this world. A lukewarm Christian won't pick sides. They'll run from the responsibility of choosing between righteousness and worldliness. Meaning instead what they'll try to do, and sometimes they work harder at doing this than actually choosing, but they'll try to figure out a way that they could have it both ways. They could be worldly, yet still be righteous. It doesn't work that way. You can't. Because the world is not righteous. You cannot serve two masters. It doesn't work that way. But there are some that will try. Those that try, more than likely, are lukewarm Christians. Now this one kind of hurts a little bit because I've known a couple of people like this. You expect God to conform to the will of people. You expect God to conform to what you think God should be. Instead of encouraging people to conform to the will of God. Instead of following the Bible and what God has spelled out so clearly for us, a lukewarm Christian will allow society, they'll allow the world to alter or redefine what things mean. A few examples of this was the world's redefined what marriage should mean, what gender is, what social justice means, what reformation is, and the newest one that just came out recently, what a revival is. Because, of course, everyone wants to tout, they've had a revival. Again, lukewarm Christians will allow society and allow the world to change the meaning of God's words. All these things that I've just described, they apply to the church that Jesus stood at the door of. The question is, do any of these things apply to you? Do any of these things, even in the minute littlest of bit, describe how you are? If so, it's not too late to repent. It's not too late to apologize to the Lord for straying and ask Him to place you back on the right track. Deserves the same response that He gives us. anything that God gives us, he deserves tenfold. Whether it be commitment, faith, God has a lot of faith in us. He must have. We have free will. Yet he gives us enough free will that we can do whatever we'd like. But we have the chance to do what's right. We have the chance to return to him. God deserves the same response he gives us. And do you know that when we knock at God's door, he always answers? Always. And never fails. In Luke 11, 9 and 10, it says, "So I say to you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be open to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, it will be open." Even after hearing all of our excuses that we can come up with, all of our whining of how it's not fair, all of our blaming God for things that go wrong, isn't it a comfort to know that God still answers when we knock on his door? I know there's some of you who may be watching, maybe thinking, "I've knocked on God's door when I prayed and I asked God for something. I didn't get it. I didn't receive what I wanted." The thing is that you're missing the big picture. You've knocked on God's door. You brought it to him. You asked for something. And as much as we hate it, grown adults and children alike, human beings hate the word no. They hate being told no. But sometimes God's answer is no. I had to come to grips with that just recently. Because I knocked on God's door almost hourly for a week. And I said, "God, just give me this one. Just give me time." I was sitting with a new believer who had an infectious way of looking at the Bible. As a child, if you watch children and all the wonder of the things that they see, it's great. You take them to someplace they've never been, and everything is wondrous to them. Their eyes get bigger. And the only word that they can use is magic. It's magical. When I was sitting with Jeremy and talking on the phone, we FaceTime a couple times, but he had that same look when he would read the scripture. He had that same zest, that same zeal. And I went and I knocked on God's door and I said, "God, more time. That's what I need. More time." God's answer was no. I can wrestle with God all I want on this. I will lose every time. As human beings, we tend to want to wrestle with God on these things. We lose every time. What we have to remember is that whatever it is that we're going through, whatever it is that we knocked on God's door for, whatever the answer is, it's what's best for us. I'm still trying to wrestle with the idea of what happened being best for me. But the thing is, I've already seen the results. Something wondrous, something great happened as a result of what happened. God's answer was no, but there was salvation that came from it. So God does say no. God uses the negative for positive no matter what. Today, right now, the Lord's standing at your door. He's knocking. He's calling on you. He could be saying anything. He could be saying, "Come to me, those who are weary." Because he knows that your trials and tribulations are heavy for you. He may be saying to you, "We need to talk more." I don't know one person They can say, nope, I talk to Jesus enough. I talk to God way too much. Nope. Maybe Jesus is saying, you got a minute to talk? Maybe he's saying you need to rededicate your life to him and place him as your first priority in life. Maybe your priorities have been screwed up. Maybe work has become more important than anything else. Maybe the Lord's knocking at your door right now to say, hey, reprioritize what you're doing. Maybe he's telling you need to have a church home. Perhaps right now, he's knocking and he's saying, where you're at right now, listening to this message, this is where you should be. Whatever it is that he's saying to you today, I want to encourage you to not delay to open your door. You'll find that God's door is always open to you. And he has told us we will find, no matter how hard we try and try not to, but we will find when we seek him. And for those who are non-believers, yes, I'm going to use this to talk to you as well. The Lord may be knocking on your door right now, and he may be saying, it's time to come home. It's time to let me in. It's time to accept your salvation. If that's what's being laid on your heart, then don't delay. Not another moment should go by before you accept that gift. I'm going to ask Brother Bill to come up and join me as we have some time for reflection and prayer. I want you to take this time. I want you to knock on God's door, and I want you to bring everything that you've been carrying lately. All the worries, all the pain, all the sorrow, all the joys. Bring everything to God. Give it to him. And if you have not yet accepted so great a gift as your salvation, now's the time. Don't waste it. Choose today to be the day of your salvation. I thank God for each and every one of you. Brother Bill, can you close us in prayer?
Please, everyone, stand in honor of our Lord as we close in prayer. Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, let those that wonder hear. You're knocking at the door, Christians, non-Christians alike. Guide us to open the door, Lord, and let you in, that we can continue with you and accept your free gifts of eternal life, and we can have a life more abundant through you, Lord. Thank you for this message that you gave today, Lord, and those that heard it, may it touch lives and change lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us